Welcome to Powered by Snowflake, a series where I interview technology leaders building applications and businesses on Snowflake. I'm your host, Daniel Myers, and today I'm talking with Dan Silberman, co-founder and CTO at Mozart Data. Mozart Data is an all-in-one modern data platform powered by Snowflake. Dan, how are you today?
I'm doing great. Thanks for inviting me.
So I want to learn more about, you know, you as co-founder of Mozart Data. What made you want to start this company, and what is the founding story?
The founding story is basically me and my friend Pete. We've been friends for 20 years. We've kind of been working in and around Silicon Valley. He's more of a data analyst. I'm more of a data engineer, have done some data science. We both found ourselves in between jobs, and so we kind of started brainstorming possible startup ideas. One, I think, great way to think about startup ideas is kind of think of internal tools, or basically think of things that you've built or have used at a previous company that you would miss at a future company. So we were talking about this, and like I was kind of explaining, here's some of the tools that we built for the team of analysts at my last job. And he's like, oh yeah, we called that avocado at this company, and we built similar thing at this other company. And so we're like, okay, this is a very common thing. We keep kind of building similar tools throughout our career. Let's do it one more time, but this time in a way where anybody can use it.
I love it. And I really love the name Mozart Data. That's pretty cool. How did you come up with that name?
It's basically a play on orchestration, data orchestration. We had some other ideas that might have been trademark infringing. Some of our stuff is Mario Data because Mario is in pipes. But that's worrisome. So went with something that we didn't think we'd have any issues with, and Mozart Data.
Well, I think you came up with something good. So what is the current growth rate for Mozart Data today? How are you continuing to grow this company? What's its history?
So we were founded basically right at the start of the pandemic. We've been a fully remote company for the life of it. Pete and I were basically doing this brainstorming March of 2020. So 2.5 years old now. We raised a pretty decent Series A about a year ago. We've been growing our customer base, growing our employee base. We're at about 25 full-time employees now, have been growing steadily as far as like revenue month to month, and things have been going great.
So Dan, tell me, what do you mean by modern data stack? I hear that a lot in the industry. How does that manifest itself specifically for Mozart Data?
Well, in general, the modern data stack is kind of the idea that companies have more and more of their data created in all sorts of different tools, the explosion of SaaS. So, you know, most companies have, maybe you've got an application database powering your application, and then you maybe use Stripe, use Salesforce, use a number of advertising tools. And so you've got, you know, critical data to your business spread out across all these tools. So the modern data stack is kind of the idea, the best way to do analysis is going to be pull all that data out of those tools, centralize it into Snowflake, basically, and then do some work to organize, combine that data, and then use it for whatever you need. Sometimes that's put it back into those other tools. Sometimes, very often, it's use a business intelligence tool. So you can answer questions that span different of these data sources. So Mozart Data tries to make that paradigm really easy and kind of open it up to more people.
That makes a lot of sense. So from here, let's see a demo of this platform that you've built.
Perfect. So this is the landing page of Mozart. What has already happened here, this demo environment already has some data in it, but typically if you sign up for Mozart Data, 10 seconds later, we've created some Snowflake databases, some Snowflake warehouses under the hood, some users, roles, et cetera, kind of giving you a good default starting spot. But this will be generally empty, so let me back up a second and show you what I was talking about before. So we support over 300 data sources now. This is a combination of us. We work with a few different partners. Some of them we build. And so this is what I was saying before. You know, you've got data spread across all sorts of different data sources, and you really need to be able to pull that into your Snowflake database so that you can make some use of it. We have over 300, and we'll also work with customers to pull other data sources in. It's very common where we'll talk to somebody and they'll have, you know, five of our very common, most popular connectors, and then, you know, they're like, oh, but we also have critical data in this trucking CRM that nobody covers as far as ETL tools. But if it's critical to your business, then we'll help you find ways, or we or our partners will build that connector for you. So that's generally step one, is hook up your data sources, start pulling in that data. So these are five example connectors. I think for this demo, I'll talk about Salesforce and Stripe. So we've got our Salesforce data connected. This generally is one of the simpler ones to connect. This could literally take a minute if you're a Salesforce admin. Similar with Stripe, that's probably like a 5-minute setup. So now we've got our Salesforce data coming in every 30 minutes. We've got Stripe coming in every 30 minutes. You can control that, and there's some other deeper controls in different cases. So then we'll start pulling all that data in. This again is sort of the menu of your Snowflake database. So these right here are schemas. So that Salesforce connector is pulling in data into the Salesforce schema and these tables. We can see when they were last synced, how big they are, et cetera. Some tools like tagging and things like that that are built on top of Snowflake. So now you've got all your data, at least it's centralized. For some folks, that's really all they need. Then you hook up a BI tool, Tableau, Looker, whatever you prefer, or we can export this data straight to Google Sheets, and now you've got, you know, your Salesforce and Stripe data in Google Sheets, and you can go from there. But very frequently, kind of the next step, more of the organizing step, is in what we call transform. So let me demo this one. So any BI tool or directly within Snowflake, of course, you could then query your data. So here we're kind of running a query that's pulling out a lot of the tables that we don't need. We can see this Stripe invoice table actually has a ton of different columns. We're going to kind of clean it up and create some extra columns that are just going to be more useful so that you don't have to repeat work downstream in your BI tool. So we can run this query, of course, but we also make it really easy to start building out your pipelines. So we just want to say, hey, we want to run this and create a new table whenever that invoice table from Stripe gets updated. So we save that, and I'll show it in a little bit of a cleaner way. Let me go to this one. So for example, this is a little pipeline that would be pretty quick to set up that is basically whenever our Salesforce data gets updated, we're going to do this cleanup step. And then whenever our Stripe data gets updated, we're going to do this Stripe cleanup step. And then this is a transform that is combining those two. So we make it really easy to build data pipelines without writing anything other than some SQL. We'll manage all of the scheduling and things like that. We do some clever things like parsing the SQL that you've written so that we know this is dependent on these, and just run this right after those other things run. A number of other features that kind of make a data analyst job easier. So you can, you know, you can write alerts on top of these. These are used for kind of two things: data validation, if you just want to say, hey, this should never have any nulls in it, or the email column must always be distinct. Make that really easy. We also have a number of customers that are using these alerts for basically more like operational alerting. So, hey, tell us if like we had no revenue yesterday because either something went bad in sales or something went bad in our data pipelines. We use those pretty heavily to just track that everything going in our customers' accounts is going as it should be. Then various other features that I won't go into too much detail with, some version tracking stuff. We have a Google Sheet sync. We don't get too heavily into kind of the reverse ETL part of a modern data stack. Shout out to one of our best partners, HighTouch. You talked to Tejas pretty recently. Good guy. We'll put a link to that talk right there. And then some like audit logs and things like that. But that's the gist of a transform. And then we have some various other tools that make sort of the work that a data analyst typically does. We try to make it really easy. I want to show one other example of that. So like in this Shopify schema, we've got this inventory level table. So this is a table, we're syncing it every 30 minutes, I think in this case. It's basically going to just keep track. This is how much of everything that you sell you have at a given time. Very useful, but just with that table, you won't have a history of it. So we make it super easy. You just say, hey, I want to snapshot this table, toggle this switch, and then we'll give you a separate table, snapshots.shopify inventory level, which is basically a full history of that table, so that it makes it really easy to see how your inventory of different things has changed over time. Snowflake is so fast that these sorts of queries backing up like this is really fast, really cheap. Storage is ridiculously cheap. Our customers ask all the time, if I snapshot all these tables, is that going to be too expensive? And storage these days is so cheap that it's like, if you think you will ever want that, just click the toggle and you'll be glad you did in the future.
So this platform that you've built is incredibly powerful, and I love the level of integration that you're using to really leverage the power of Snowflake. Tell me more about some of the key features of Snowflake that your product leverages heavily?
Organizations is pretty key, obviously. It makes, for one, some of our customers, you know, they start, we are a really easy way to get started with Snowflake. And then maybe 2 years later, you've hired in a big data team and they want to kind of own that relationship. Because of organizations, it's basically talk to sales and they will move the account from the Mozart Data organization into the other customer's organization. All the role-based access control, all the separation of compute and storage is really, really nice. We take advantage of a lot of the metadata features. So information schema, a lot of this, like, you know, this particular view is powered by information schema. I didn't show, we have some features around usage that is coming out of like the Snowflake database that's in each account. So you can tag queries, you can check the full query history. So we can really help like any workload that you do within Mozart, we tag that so that we can then show you later, hey, like here's how much you're spending for this to create this table. Here's how much you're spending for this pipeline. As well as just show you, hey, you're spending a lot of money on this pipeline or pulling in this data and nobody has actually queried it in 6 months. So like maybe you want to turn that off.
How has, one of the features that you mentioned, right, is that scaling up and down of compute and storage. Mm-hmm. What, specifically around the compute side, what a lot of folks that I talk to, it doesn't immediately click for them that you can actually spin up compute from other compute. So you can have, you know, teams with dedicated compute that mm-hmm. is accessing that same piece of data,
yeah.
but doesn't impact another team's queries. How has something like that been valuable for Mozart Data?
I think that like the simplest example here is humans don't really want to wait 40 seconds for their query. So, but machines, if you have a background job that is like, hey, we need this table to be refreshed every 6 hours every day. If that needs to queue a little bit or that query can run a little bit slower, nobody's actively waiting for it. So you can control differently which compute resources are doing which sort of jobs. That's probably the biggest place that we control it is like have the best experience for humans. Computers can stand waiting a minute here and there.
So from here, what should your customers get the most excited about over the next 6 to 12 months in your product roadmap?
So one big thing that we're thinking about, I didn't really show in the demo yet, kind of the BI layer. Under the hood, like I said, it's Snowflake, so anything that hooks up to Snowflake. So our customers use a variety of BI tools. We'll also host Metabase for some of our customers. But because we sort of see patterns in how people are manipulating their data and the end use cases, so the end charts, the analysis that they're actually doing, we know kind of the schema, the structure of the data as it lands in Snowflake, and we see all the way to the end of, you know, what are people trying to look at, that we're trying to kind of build out more of that for you automatically so we can do some of the transforming for you. We can build out better tables that are a combination of some of your data sources. And depending on the tools you're using, we can just say, here's 10 charts that we think you're gonna want. If you don't want them, you can delete them, but it's at least like a good place to start. Kind of going back to one of our core design principles, smart defaults, but with flexibility, which is certainly enabled by Snowflake being under the hood. Whatever you see in Mozart, if we're not making easy what you want to do, you can always just go into Snowflake and do it yourself.
That makes a lot of sense. And so I want to back up a little bit. And, you know, so some of those features that you mentioned, right? How did you go about evaluating Snowflake when at the very beginning of your product, you know, creation phase? Mm-hmm. And how did you ultimately land on Snowflake as the data cloud that you build your platform on?
So we evaluated a few different possibilities. I had never used Snowflake actually before Mozart Data, just hadn't really been at that stage. But I'd heard good things about it. We talked to a lot of people. Like before we kind of landed on this is the product we're going to build, we talked to a lot of potential customers and see what their pain points are. And from that kind of came the idea of, okay, a lot of people, they have nothing. They know they want to be more data driven. Some folks are like, well, we've been waiting on engineering for 6 months to spin up this stuff, but I just want to query my Salesforce data in my BI tool. If you could get me everything set up, then we'll do that. So that was kind of like where we landed. And then it was, yeah, evaluating what is going to be the database under the hood. We tried a few. The separation of compute and storage is a huge, you know, relatively unique feature. It was a big selling point. The docs really, like just working with Snowflake is really nice. I think one thing that people don't kind of talk about enough maybe is that the other competitors in the space are kind of, they're a department inside of a giant tech company, where Snowflake is a whole company, at the whole organization, everybody is just thinking about how do we make this data cloud better, easier to use, cheaper, et cetera. So back in 2020, our conclusion was basically, it seems to be the best now, and it's most likely to, you know, improve faster than the other options. So it's a no-brainer, and I definitely don't have any regrets.
Awesome. And, you know, it's cool that you say that, because, you know, Snowflake really is, you know, thinking all about data and how to build applications through the lens of data. And so it's really encouraging to hear, you know, how that's worked really well for you, you know, in the past and moving into the future. Dan, it's been great having you in the studio today. If people want to learn more about you and about Mozart Data, where should they go?
Thanks for having me. Yeah, if you want to learn more about Mozart Data or try a free trial, request a demo, or if you just want to talk about your data problems and maybe we can help, you can find out more at mozartdata.com.
And thanks to everyone watching. To see more interviews like this with tech leaders building applications on Snowflake, check out our other videos on YouTube and be sure to subscribe. My name is Daniel Myers, and this has been another episode of Powered by Snowflake.